Regarding his spiritual characteristics, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, reported in the Sunan of Ibn Majah, that the Mahdi shall be from the Ahlul Bayt. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will rectify him in one night, will make him good in one night. This is an interesting hadith because it tells us that the Mahdi in the younger portion of his life will not be as practicing of a Muslim as he should be. He will not be to the level that he is worthy of being. Something will happen, we don't know what. And in one night, he shall repent. And he shall become basically the most pious person on earth. He will not be born like this. He will not be raised as an alim and since the beginning memorized the Quran. No, this is not the case of the Mahdi. The Mahdi, we don't know what level, but it says that in one night, Allah will purify him and correct him. Allah will yuslih. Yuslih means he wasn't salih before. He wasn't pious before. So the Mahdi will not be to the level of piety that we would expect him to be. In one night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then cause him to repent. As Ibn Kathir said, he will repent from his ways and he will become basically the most pure person on earth. We also know that in the times that he will come, we said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly said that the time shall be of the worst of times. That the entire earth shall be filled with evil and injustice. And that is something that very rarely happens. That the entire earth, you see fitna and fasad. And you see Muslim blood being shed. And you see the Muslims being humiliated everywhere you look. Hardly ever has this occurred in the Ummah. That when it does occur, that is one of the times that we can expect to come a Mahdi figure. Now the question arises, where shall he appear from? Of course, the timing, nobody knows. If we knew when the Mahdi will appear, we will know when Isa will come and the Dajjal will come. And then we will know when the Day of Judgment will come roughly. Nobody knows. And I have read many articles in English and seen references in Urdu. Certain people now spreading, the Mahdi will appear in this year. And they mention a specific year. And they have calculated this from I don't know how. Anytime somebody makes a prediction, any prediction, you can guarantee he is a liar. Allah says in the Quran, no one knows what will happen tomorrow. No one knows. Anybody says that on this day this will happen, and on this time and this year this will happen, this person is lying. Either he is crazy and he's the pen has been lifted from him, so Allah will not punish him, or he is a Dajjal pretending to know ilm al-ghayb. One of the two. It cannot be anything other than this. Any time a prediction is made, such a person is not an alim to make this prediction. So the timing of the Mahdi, nobody knows. And we should not even estimate. We should not say, oh, we're living in a time of fitna and fasad, perhaps this is the time. No. Only Allah knows. Only Allah knows. And by the way, we don't want to be alive when the Mahdi comes. Why? Because right after the Mahdi, the Dajjal will come. In his lifetime, the Dajjal will come. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is no fitna that mankind has been afflicted with that is worse than the Dajjal. From the beginning of times until the Day of Judgment, there is no fitna that is more severe to mankind than the Dajjal. We don't want to be alive when the Dajjal comes. And when the Mahdi comes, in his lifetime the Dajjal will come. So we don't want to see that timing. And we seek Allah's refuge from being alive at that time. So don't sit there and say, oh inshallah he's coming soon. Because you don't want to be at that time when all of these fitan will occur. Only Allah knows when the Mahdi will come. We don't know when he will come. But we do know where he will come from. The location is known. Now the location of the Mahdi is something that is slight dispute amongst the ulama. This is because there are two sets of ahadith regarding the Mahdi. The first set of hadith mentions that the Mahdi shall come from the east. In another narration, then the country is mentioned from Khurasan. And Khurasan, in our times, these are portions of Afghanistan and Bukhara and all of these areas that are above the areas of India, Pakistan. They're more northerly and more easterly. All of this was called Khurasan. Even portions of Iran come under the classical name of Khurasan. This is the first set of ahadith, that they shall appear from Khurasan. The second set of ahadith mentioned that he shall appear from Medina. And so the scholars have differed. How do we reconcile these two sets of ahadith? Let us quote some of these ahadith and then present one opinion on the issue. Of these ahadith is the hadith mentioned in Ibn Majah and also in the Mustadrak of Al-Hakim that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And this is an authentic hadith. Three groups of people shall fight for your treasure. Three groups of Muslims shall fight for your treasure. And each of these three leaders will be sons of a Khalifa. There will be three princes. Okay, their fathers were Khalifas. So three princes, if you like, he didn't say princes, he said sons of Khalifa, will fight over your treasure. The scholars of hadith said the treasure being referred to is the treasure buried underneath the Kaaba. There is a major treasure buried underneath the Kaaba. We don't know exactly where it is buried to this day. It was buried by the tribe of Jurhum. It was buried in the ancient times, before the coming of the Prophet ﷺ by many, many, many years. It was buried when the tribe was being attacked by a neighboring tribe, and so they gathered all of their treasures and they buried them in a location around the Kaaba. We don't know where. And they also hid the well of Zamzam. And you all know that Abdul Muttalib discovered the well of Zamzam, he rediscovered it. Okay, when this invading army was coming, they hid the well of Zamzam and they buried all of their gold and all of the money that they had, they buried it there because they didn't want the enemy tribe to take it. So that treasure, three princes will fight over it inside of the Haram. There shall occur battle there inside of the Haram. And the Prophet said, none of them shall win. They're not going to find this and none of them will win over the other two. None of them shall win. Then he said, there shall come black flags from the east. There shall come black flags from the east. And then a war shall ensue between the Muslims that no nation has ever happened. The severity of the war. No ummah has ever undergone such a severe war. So he is saying black flags will come from the east, meaning the lands of Khorasan. Another narration in the Muslim Imam Ahmad says, when you see these black flags, then realize that the Mahdi will be with them. Realize that there will be the Mahdi. Sorry, he didn't say with them, he said there will be the Mahdi. So when you see the black flags, give bay'ah to the Mahdi, even if you have to crawl on snow to get to him. Even if you have to crawl on snow, when you see these black flags, make sure you get to the Mahdi and give your bay'ah to him. And there are other narrations which mention that there shall be an army from the east, from Khorasan as we said, and they shall have these rayat as-sud, or the black flags. There is another narration which mentions as well the country, and this is Khorasan, and this is in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. Sunan al-Tirmidhi, there is a hadith that mentions, there shall come from Khorasan black flags, and they shall continue until they reach Jerusalem, and nothing will be able to stop them. They will reconquer Jerusalem. So in this hadith, we find two facts mentioned. The first, that an army, it doesn't mention the Mahdi. The other hadith mentions there will be the Mahdi with the black flags. This hadith in Tirmidhi says there shall be an army from Khorasan. It shall march forth. Nothing will stop them until they reach Jerusalem, Bayt al-Maqdis, and they shall basically take it over. They shall free it. Once again, this hadith would be quite explicit except for one problem. It is weak. Therefore, if this hadith were authentic, we could say that one of the signs of the Mahdi is that he shall reconquer Jerusalem. And if that was the case, then in our times, of course, this is a lot of hope for us. But this hadith is not authentic. And when a hadith is not authentic, by the way, we have to be careful that we don't go to extremes. Some people say if a hadith is weak, it is the same as if it's fabricated. This is wrong. A hadith is weak means it is between mawdu' and sahih. Means maybe it's authentic, maybe it's not. We don't know. So there is a possibility that this hadith is right.